Welcome. This is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is Exploration. Every week in Exploration, we discuss the fascinating world of science and its impact on society. And today, leading off, we're going to summarize some of the top stories of the past week. Our lead story today is killer satellite warfare in outer space. The Indian government announced that it has successfully tested an ASAT weapon, an anti-satellite weapon, and many people fear this could start a new arms race between India and Pakistan, India and China. And this will also put pressure on President Donald Trump because he wants to push the Space Force. And so this could be a real mess if we have warfare in outer space. And then the question is, can artificial intelligence tell you how long you're going to live? This is not such an academic question, because the baby boomers, well, they're retiring now. And after retirement, well, you go to old age. And then after that, well, let's face it, you die. But the question is, can computers predict how long you will live? Well, we'll have some surprising results from the United Kingdom, where they use artificial intelligence to try to determine that fact. Also, pain, of all things, is in the news. On one hand, we have the opioid crisis, where people by the tens of thousands are dying because they want relief from pain. But on the other hand, there's a 71-year-old woman in Scotland who feels no pain whatsoever. And scientists sequenced her genes and were rather surprised when they found out the origin of why she feels no pain. She even gave birth to a child and felt nothing. So we'll talk about pain and also pain in artificial intelligence. At some point, many people think that robots may eventually feel pain. And if so, then perhaps we'll have a robots' rights movement to restrict the amount of pain they feel. And speaking about robots, one question that I get in email a lot is the future of the job market. What jobs are going to go kaput, like blacksmiths of old and wagon makers? We don't have blacksmiths. We don't have wagon makers anymore, but we don't really care anymore either. But what about the jobs of today? What jobs are going to be obliterated by the computer revolution? And what jobs are going to flourish as a consequence? And so we'll talk about the job market and the future. Which jobs are going to be impacted? What majors should you declare in high school and college? And if you're thinking about switching jobs because you got laid off, are you going to switch into another dead-end job? We'll talk about artificial intelligence and the job market on Exploration. Well, let's just jump right into some of the top stories of the past week. The lead story today, well, it didn't get much coverage in the Western press, but it got a lot of coverage in the East, and that is the Indian government successfully tested a killer satellite weapon. They were able to blow one of their own satellites right out of space. And the question is, what does that mean? First of all, it's going to put pressure on Pakistan. Because, for example, when the Indians successfully tested an atomic bomb, there was a lot of pressure on Pakistan to develop its own atomic bomb. And now that the Indians have successfully tested a killer satellite weapon, well, there's going to be pressure on Pakistan to test its killer satellite weapon as well. Plus, there's going to be even more pressure on the Chinese, because the Chinese have already perfected their killer satellite weapon, and they have to maintain that lead over India. Not to mention the fact it's going to put more pressure on President Donald Trump, because space war is in the news. President Donald Trump wants to have a space force, another branch of the military. Well, first of all, let me say this. Who has killer satellite technology? The United States, Russia, and China. And now we have a fourth power capable of blowing a satellite out of the sky. Now, you may say to yourself, well, what's the big deal? I mean, after all, these satellites are not guns. They're not battleships in outer space. No, but they're the eyes and ears of a government at the beginning stages of a war. Let's say you have two gunfighters, and one gunfighter reaches for sand, throws dirt and sand in the eyes of the enemy, blinding the enemy, and then at leisure, you can pick off the enemy. So in other words, blinding the enemy in the opening shots of a nuclear war would give you a tremendous first strike advantage. And that's what killer satellite technology is all about. But you know, the Chinese have an expression, never pick up a rock, only to drop it on your own feet. And so the question is, will we pick up a rock, this rock of killer satellite technology, only to drop it on our own feet? Well, first of all, who is most vulnerable to killer satellite technology? Well, we are, the United States, because we are the ones who field over half the satellites there in outer space are connected to the United States commercially and militarily. And it doesn't take much. It doesn't take much to knock a satellite out of orbit. Even the North Koreans will have the capability of one day shooting an atomic bomb in outer space, detonating it, and wiping out not one, but hundreds of satellites. Because you see, satellites are sitting ducks to a first strike. Satellites are not reinforced. Satellites are not maneuverable. Satellites don't have any defensive systems. Satellites are just sitting ducks out there. So some people think that a small country could send a barrel of nails into outer space, detonate it, and all that shrapnel from a barrel of nails would be enough to wipe out quite a few satellites. And as I said, if you detonate an atomic bomb in outer space, the electromagnetic pulse would be sufficient to knock out not one, not two, but hundreds of satellites in outer space. So in other words, it could be a real mess. It could be a real mess if killer satellite technology gets out of hand. Because once it starts, because satellites are so vulnerable and so essential, once it starts, you cannot stop it. Once it starts, it's going to basically ricochet and create a chain reaction, and then thousands of satellites could be affected. And at that point, nations who are blind are going to reach for the most convenient weapon, and that is the hydrogen bomb. And so we have a real mess here. Hopefully, the nations of the world can reinforce the Outer Space Treaty of 1967. The Outer Space Treaty banned nuclear weapons in outer space, but said nothing about conventional killer satellite technology. And many people think that that's how war is going to start. War is going to start when there's an accident or a deliberate detonation of a weapon that blinds the enemy in a fight. And speaking about fights, how long will you live? You know, the baby boomers are getting older. They're hitting retirement age and beyond. And after that, you look forward to your golden years. And after that, well, let's face it, you die. That's a law of physics, in fact. But again, the question is, can artificial intelligence predict when you're going to die? Now, this is not an academic question, because hundreds of billions of dollars are invested in that question, specifically the insurance companies. The insurance companies hire top mathematicians and demographers in order to calculate, more or less statistically speaking, when you're going to die. But that's all done by hand. What about robots? Can artificial intelligence do this? Well, there's a group at the University of Nottingham in the United Kingdom that says, well, maybe. They got computers with artificial intelligent capabilities, and they fed them data, publicly available data, of 500,000 people. And then they placed bets of the three computer programs, which computer program would give you the best estimate of when you're going to die. Well, the first program basically analyzed physical activity and ethnicity. The second model looked at body fat, waist size, and the amount of fruits and vegetables you ate in your diet. And the third was very interesting. The third used deep learning. Deep learning looks at enormous amounts of data and then tries to figure out lessons behind all this massive amount of data, and they try again. Each time, they get closer and closer to the correct result. Now, that's how babies learn. Basically, it's a school of hard knocks. You try something, you fail, you size it up, you try it again and again. That's how you learn. In fact, when babies begin to speak, scientists have put tape recorders inside the baby crib, and they were rather surprised. At night, babies babble. Well, of course babies babble. But what do they babble? They repeat the sounds over and over again that they heard during the daytime. And that's how they learn, by hearing the mistakes, correcting the mistakes, and trying it all over again. Well, anyway, that's called deep learning, and robots today are beginning to use deep learning software. So the third program that they used looked at alcohol, job-related hazards, certain drugs, and then they had the machine learn from these mistakes. Well, when they looked at the data from these three computer programs, it turns out that the deep learning program was, in fact, the best. Now, what does this mean for you? First of all, let's be frank. These are statistical models. These are models that look at data from hundreds of thousands of deaths, and your situation may be unique. And so it's not going to give you a direct guidance. However, that said, it also gives you demographic information of the probability of how long you're going to live, given the fact you may have bad habits. Specifically, keep your weight down, exercise could be the fountain of youth, in fact, eat right, vegetables and fruits, keep your cholesterol level down, your blood pressure down, take moderate amounts of alcohol. And these are common sense things, but in some sense, they work. Doesn't work for everybody, but statistically, it works if you use common sense. There's a lot of information out there showing that your diet, lack of smoking, moderate drinking, fruits and vegetables, exercise, things like that, common sense, that's the way to go. You don't necessarily have to get all the latest diet books and fads. No, just use common sense. And all these computer programs pretty much show that you can predict how long you're going to live given all the factors that reduce your lifespan, like being overweight and lack of exercise. Also in the news, from Scotland, there is a woman who is 71 years of age who feels no pain. That's right. She doesn't feel pain. In fact, she doesn't experience anxiety or worries. When she gave birth to a child, she felt no pain whatsoever. And many people think, wow, this could have a tremendous impact because look at the opioid crisis. Tens of thousands of people are dying. In some areas of the United States, life expectancy is going down, not up. Down because of an increase, a surge in opioid overdoses. And so some people are saying, maybe there's a safer way. This woman's not addicted. It's just her genes that allow her to experience no pain. Well, let's be blunt about this. She's not the first person that scientists have studied that feels no pain. In fact, for the last 100 years, scientists have analyzed individuals born without pain sensors. But there's a plus and a minus. You see, there's a reason why evolution gave us the ability to feel pain. There's a reason, because if we feel pain, chances are something bad is causing the pain. It turns out that many young children who are born without pain sensors eventually lose their fingers because they don't feel any pain. So if there's a sharp object, for example, that's inflicting damage to their fingers, they don't feel it. What happens is, over time, all these cuts and bruises and burns accumulate, and doctors have to amputate their fingers and toes as a consequence. So in other words, there's a reason. There's a reason why we feel pain. Now, this woman was a little bit different. because she felt no pain, but she healed rather quickly. Yes, she had burns. Yes, she had cuts. But they healed quickly, and so looking at her, you would never notice that there was anything wrong. Plus the fact she was cheerful. She was always happy. Did she ever experience worry and dread and anxiety? No. She was pretty much a happy-go-lucky person. When she gave birth to a child, she felt no pain whatsoever. In fact, it had a negative effect because it turns out that she needed hip replacement, but she didn't feel it. She didn't feel any pain in her hips until finally she realized that, yes, something was definitely wrong. And then it turns out that, yes, her hips were degenerating, but she couldn't feel anything. And so there's a plus and a minus for people who feel no pain. Well, doctors sequenced her genes and were shocked to find that she had a mutation that doctors had never seen before. It was a new mutation, a mutation that perhaps allowed her to heal faster as a consequence of not feeling the pain of cuts and bruises. And perhaps that gene was also responsible for the fact that she was always cheerful. Now, there is a downside. Doctors realize that she's also rather forgetful. And there are certain characteristics that she has that perhaps are not advantageous. But in the main, she did not feel many of the negative effects that other people feel who are born without the pain sensors. Now, it turns out that her father also probably had it, but he passed away. She remembered as a child that her father also apparently was happy-go-lucky and didn't experience much pain. But she has a daughter, and the daughter only partially inherited some of the characteristics. So the daughter does not have the full capability of not feeling pain. Now, what does this have to do with you and me? First of all, this gene is not for everyone, because it means that, yes, there's a downside. You could have burns and cuts and never be aware of it. But also, we may be able to figure out biochemically how it works and then modulate it, control it, so that we can create painkillers without having addiction, without having overdoses, and without having all the problems of the opioid crisis. So anyway, her genes are being sequenced, her genes are being analyzed, and they're quite novel. Another pathway by which one day we may be able to control pain and anxiety and depression without the serious side effects. And then one thing I get in emails, I get a lot of emails from people, one consistent theme is the job market. People are anxious. They see the movies. They hear all the buzz about robots and artificial intelligence, and they say, uh-oh, am I in a dead-end job? Or if you're a student, are you going to go into a job that has no future? Or if you got laid off, are you going to go to another job that will also lay you off in the future? Well, let's talk about it, because we've had a number of guests on Exploration talking about the job market. First of all, in the future, what will the jobs be like in the future? I think that in the future, the jobs will be those jobs that robots cannot do. That's being blunt about it. The jobs of the future will be those jobs that robots cannot do. Then the obvious question is, well, what are the jobs that robots cannot do? Well, there are three categories of jobs. And so you may want to learn them now because this is going to affect your life into the future. First of all, what can robots do very well? Robots, we forget, are adding machines. They add millions of times faster than us, giving us the illusion they are thinking, but they're not thinking at all. They're basically adding machines, and they do two things well. One is repetitive tasks that can be done over and over and over again. And second, data processing, analyzing huge, huge chunks of data to glean any kind of lesson or valuable insight from this large amount of data. And so basically, there are three kinds of jobs that are going to survive into the future. The first job may surprise you, And that is the job of blue-collar workers. Jobs that require semi-skilled knowledge, manual dexterity, pattern recognition. Jobs like gardeners. Jobs like sanitation men, garbage men, custodians. Jobs like policemen. Jobs like plumbers. Yes, they will have jobs into the future. No robot can fix a broken toilet. No robot can pick up garbage. No robot can fix faulty wiring. No robot can solve a crime. Now think about it for a moment. What do all these semi-skilled jobs have in common? First, you do not need a college education, but they require semi-skills that are non-repetitive. For example, to be a policeman, you have to understand the mind of the criminal, and you have to make all these value judgments that robots cannot make at all. Take a look at a garbage man. Every piece of garbage is different. Every piece of garbage requires a different set of abilities on the part of the sanitation worker. Think of an electrician. Every piece of wiring is different. And so these are semi-skilled jobs not requiring a college education, and they will generate jobs into the future. Another category of jobs is jobs that require human interaction skills. For example, take a look at a law firm. The paralegal that looks up precedences, they may be out the window because data crunching and search engines, well, that's what robots can do. They can process data much faster than a paralegal. Looking up precedences, looking up codes, things that are very tedious, well, that's what robots can do faster than a paralegal. But only a human can argue to a jury. Only a human can argue to a judge. Only a human understands changing moral standards. Only a human can convince another human of unpopular ideas. So, in other words, we're talking about lawyers that deal with human activity. They will have jobs. Now, take a look at my job. I'm a professor, and some people say, ha, computers are going to replace you guys because already we have e-courses. In the future, students will have the internet in their contact lens. They'll simply blink, and they'll see all the lessons. So who needs a professor anymore? Well, it turns out that many courses at MIT are, in fact, available on the web for free. But what is the dropout rate in these online courses? The dropout rate approaches 90%. 90%. So yes, some poor student in Pakistan could get on the computer, download all these lectures from MIT about artificial intelligence, and learn something. But what's the problem? The problem is there's no one that these people can talk to for advice, career guidance, homework assignments, answering specific questions about technology. None of that. So in other words, in the future, professors are going to be less and less regurgitators of technical knowledge and more mentors, career guidance counselors, teaching people the ins and outs of becoming a scientist or an engineer or a technician. And so those jobs are going to flourish because they require human skills. So in the future, human counselors, guidance counselors, career guidance people, people that deal with human activity, they will have jobs. The third category is perhaps the most important one of all, and that is intellectual capital. The capital of the mind, innovation, creativity, analysis, leadership, guidance. These jobs are going to survive in the future because robots can't do that. Robots cannot write a novel. They can copy a novel, but they can't create creative skills. And so it means that creative people, scientific people, people that involve analysis, they will have jobs. Take a look at stockbrokers. It turns out that stockbrokers no longer sell stock. Now, that may sound stupid, but it's true. You don't go to a stockbroker to buy stock anymore. You could do that on your wristwatch. So why do you go to a stockbroker? Because you want the inside dope. You want experience, know-how, savvy. You want to know the inside scoop on the stock market. You want to know where the good investments are. Robots don't know any of that. Robots can crunch numbers, sure. So stockbrokers will use computers, but for innovation, for analysis, for leadership, that's why you want to talk to a human. So in other words, intellectual capital is not just being Bill Gates and becoming a computer programmer. Yes, computer programs will have jobs in the future. But intellectual capital, capital involving creativity, leadership, artwork, these things are going to flourish in the future because robots are very bad at that. Robots can't create new jokes. They can regurgitate old jokes, but they cannot create new things. Creativity is not in the cards. Now, some people say, well, won't professors be put out of work, scientists be put out of work because robots can do the science? No. Robots are adding machines. They're aids, but they cannot replace scientists because science requires creativity and imagination. Now, take a look at being a doctor, an x-ray technician. They have to go through thousands of x-ray charts. And yes, robots can do that better than a human. That's right. Robots can spot illnesses in MRI machines and CAT scans and scans like that better than a human. But ultimately, you want a human's judgment to make the life and death call. So in the future, yes, doctors will use these programs to analyze x-ray charts. But in the final analysis, when it comes down to human skills that affect life itself, you want a seasoned doctor. So, in other words, the jobs of the future will be in three categories. First, semi-skilled, non-repetitive jobs, blue-collar jobs that require a certain amount of skills, jobs that require human interaction skills, being able to convince people, give guidance to people. And the most important category of all is intellectual capital. That is innovation, creativity, artwork, science, computer programming, telling a joke, writing a book. Believe it or not, these are way beyond the capabilities of any robot. So if you're mid-career, thinking about changing, do not change into an area where there is probably going to be a lot of dead-end jobs. Go into a job that requires skills, semi-skills of blue-collar workers, skills that require human interaction, or most important, intellectual capital. Well, that concludes the first part of Exploration. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku inviting you to join us for the second half when we continue a discussion about war in outer space. We're going to rerun an old interview that we did with Michael Moore, not the filmmaker. He's a disarmament specialist. But Michael Moore will be talking about warfare in outer space. Many people think that could be the next arena for a war, especially because of the fact that the great powers are beginning to test their weapons, this time not on the ground, this time not in the air, but this time in deep space. And so stay tuned for the second half of Exploration. Welcome. Once again, this is Dr. Michio Kaku, Professor of Theoretical Physics at the City College and the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, and this is the second half of Exploration. In the first half of Exploration, we talked about a disturbing trend, and that is the militarization of outer space. In other words, this time it's the Indian government that is crowing about the fact that they were able to shoot down another Indian satellite in outer space. This means that we now have four national powers with the capability of initiating a war in outer space: the United States, Russia, China, and now India. And it means that there's going to be pressure on Pakistan now, so it too can match its rival in the same way that the Indians got the atomic bomb and then the Pakistanis had to get the atomic bomb. And it also puts pressure on China to then modernize its ASAT capability. And so where is it going to end? Not to mention the fact that President Donald Trump is talking about a space force. And, well, we have to be careful, because who's the most vulnerable to a satellite war? We are. We control over half the satellites in orbit around the planet Earth. And it wouldn't take much to upset the entire apple cart. Even the North Koreans, for example, could in principle launch a nuclear weapon, detonate it in outer space, set off an electromagnetic pulse, which would then wipe out perhaps hundreds of satellites. And once you go blind, you become desperate. You reach for the nearest weapon when you're blind and out of control, and that could be a recipe for a war. So in other words, think of two gunslingers facing off. One of them gets sand, throws it in the eyes of the enemy. The enemy then becomes hysterical and then starts to fire everywhere, causing tremendous chaos. And so that's the problem when outer space becomes militarized. And that's why some people are saying that we should revise the Outer Space Treaty of 1967. That treaty banned nuclear weapons in space, but said nothing about non-nuclear weapons, killer satellites that can knock out other satellites by bumping into them or putting explosives on them or using laser beams to blind them and neutralize them. Well, with us today is Michael Moore, not the filmmaker. He's a peace activist, and he's the author of the book Twilight War, talking about the fact that the next area, the next arena for warfare, could be outer space. Now I'd like to bring on our special guest today. We're very delighted to have with us Michael Moore, not the filmmaker, but the weapons analyst, author of the book Twilight War, The Folly of U.S. Space Dominance. You know, the United States bombed the moon. Does it have military value? Well, not really. However, there's a larger question, and that is in the future. In the future, nations will see space as a military asset. We saw that during the Gulf War crises. And then the question is, what secret steps are nations making right now, even as we speak, to prepare for a possible war in outer space? A war that could wipe out satellites, it could cause a tremendous collapse of the industrial infrastructure as power lines go out, communications go blank, the internet is stopped. It could cause all sorts of havoc if we have a war in outer space. So with us once again is Michael Moore. The book is called Twilight War, The Folly of U.S. Space Dominance. The first question for you is, how did you first get interested in peace and disarmament issues?
I've been interested in peace and disarmament issues all my adult life, and certainly after we had children, it became a more personal thing to me. I've always thought nuclear weapons were clearly immoral, and that goes back to the 1950s.
And tell us about your involvement with the Bulletin of Atomic Scientists.
Well, I became editor in 1991 and retired in 2000, and that was the end of the Cold War. Our circulation was slipping, and I told the board at my first board meeting we should be overjoyed that our circulation was slipping, because that meant the nuclear threat was waning. But I got involved because I wanted to do whatever I could to ensure that nuclear weapons were never again used.
Okay. Now, most Americans don't know that there is a very fierce competition to dominate outer space. They heard about the Chinese test that took place several months ago, and many analysts were outraged that thousands of pieces of debris are now in orbit around the Earth as a consequence of the Chinese test. So first of all, tell us a little bit about the Chinese test.
Well, it was a test in January of last year, and they smashed an alien weather satellite, a Chinese weather satellite, with a so-called kinetic kill weapon, which means they just ran into it, smashed it into many, many thousands of pieces. It replicated a test in a rough kind of way that we conducted in 1985. The Chinese test is interesting because the Chinese have wanted us to, us meaning the United States and the rest of the world, to negotiate a new outer space treaty that would prevent any kind of conflict in space and weapons in space and space-related weapons on the ground and so on. And we have dismissed that. Every time the Chinese have brought it up, we have dismissed the idea. And I regard it as a shot across the bow. The Chinese were saying, if you intend to dominate space, we're going to challenge you. But we would rather, the Chinese would rather, negotiate a treaty.
Okay. Now let's say a few things about the past, because most people were caught flat-footed when the Chinese test took place, not realizing that there's a long history of this going all the way back to the beginning of the space age. So isn't it true that even with the launching of Sputnik back in 57, there were voices talking about a potential war in outer space?
Oh, absolutely. And President Eisenhower anticipated this kind of thing as early as 1955 and established a space for peaceful purposes policy for the United States, because he did not want to see the Cold War extended into space. He thought that would be very dangerous. Then after Sputnik, a lot of people criticized Eisenhower for being flat-footed on this issue. Actually, he wasn't. But he was widely criticized. Even his own chief of staff of the Air Force, Thomas Dresser White, argued publicly in February of 1958 that control of space should be the goal of all Americans. But Eisenhower resisted that idea. He did not want to be the first president to militarize space. He did not want to see the Cold War go into space. And that policy was followed by Kennedy and Johnson and eventually became the Outer Space Treaty of 1967, an international treaty that is still in force.
But isn't it true that even during that period of time, the United States was in fact building killer satellite systems and in fact had an operational system based in the Pacific with Thor missiles that actually detonated hydrogen bombs in outer space?
It's true that the United States researched systems, and the Soviet Union was very aggressive when it came to space. The Soviet Union, until the Outer Space Treaty, was testing various systems. The Soviet Union was even talking about putting hydrogen bombs in space or in suborbital space. There were two different systems they were talking about. And the United States was reactive in that respect. We did have a Thor system with a hydrogen bomb warhead that was to be used as an anti-satellite system. But it was a very limited system. We could launch two Thors, which wouldn't have made any real difference. And then the system was activated, but in a very clumsy kind of way. It was clear to everybody that we didn't want to use it. Nobody really wanted to use it. Then later on, we did test nuclear weapons in space, and then one, the so-called Starfish Prime test, knocked out the electrical service in parts of Hawaii, and it killed a few satellites of other nations, and we realized that exploding nuclear weapons in space was not a good idea.
And isn't it true that Robert McNamara began to be a little bit skeptical about shooting hydrogen bombs in outer space because it would create an electromagnetic pulse? In fact, wasn't this the first time we've ever seen an electromagnetic pulse in action that could wipe out our own communication systems?
You're absolutely right. The electromagnetic pulse was perceived as very dangerous to our systems and to other kinds of systems, military and civilian.
And didn't Robert McNamara actually go ahead and try to deploy a anti-ballistic missile system called the Sprint
which never became fully operational and wasted billions of dollars.
He did. He was very skeptical of it. He was pushed into it by hardliners on the right, and it was viewed as a Chinese, anti-Chinese system. It was pretty well understood by then that we could not defeat a Soviet attack, but we believed that the Chinese would someday have missiles, and then the system would at least defeat a small Chinese attack. But it was only operational for a few months, and billions of dollars were spent. It was not popular with anybody except the aerospace industry and certain senators and congressmen.
Okay, so we went through the 60s and 70s, and then in the 80s, President Ronald Reagan changes the whole landscape by talking about Star Wars, and people were talking about Buck Rogers-type laser particle beam accelerators in outer space, zapping things from outer space. What happened to the original Buck Rogers schemes?
Well, the Ronald Reagan's Star Wars scheme was kind of fantastical. He was sold on it by Edward Teller and some other people, and it was viewed as an anti-ballistic missile system, and we would have anti-ballistic missile systems in space. We would have battle stars in space and so on and so forth. It was a kind of a crazy thing. I have to say Ronald Reagan was far-reaching in one way. He believed that the mad system of mutual destruction was literally mad. He wanted to get rid of nuclear weapons, and he believed that the Star Wars system would do that. Meanwhile, there were people on his staff and in his administration. He viewed it as a way of advancing space control. If we had anti-ballistic missile systems, we could also have anti-satellite systems, and we could control space. But it just wasn't technically possible then. It may be technically possible now to hit satellites from space. It still isn't possible to hit ballistic missiles, in my opinion.
Now, if you do, in fact, have a Star Wars shield, isn't that also a potential first strike weapon? President Richard Nixon used this analogy. Nixon said, if you have two gladiators, the first gladiator strikes first, disarming most of the enemy's ability, and then you have a shield to absorb a weakened second strike from the second gladiator. So in some sense, this system is not only a defensive system, it's also an offensive first strike system, right?
You're right about that. Almost any defensive system of that kind can be viewed as part of a first strike system. And that's very dangerous, it's unstable, and that's why a lot of military people actually oppose these kinds of systems because of the dangers of being viewed as a first strike system. The people who push it most ardently tend to be civilians, people who have never been in war, don't understand war, and who have hardline ideologies.
Okay, so in the 80s came the big disappointment that Ronald Reagan's great schemes violated the known laws of physics and the known laws of technology. However, in the 90s, isn't it true that the United States kept on going with a limited off-the-shelf Star Wars system, shooting a bullet with another bullet over the Pacific?
It's true that in the 90s we continued these systems, but mainly after the fall of the Soviet Union, a new paradigm emerged, which had the support of a lot of military people as well as hardline civilian people. It went like this. The Cold War had been very dangerous to both the United States and the Soviet Union. We should not permit another existential threat to the United States. Therefore, the way to do that was to be overwhelmingly militarily dominant on land, at sea, in the air, and in space. And I'm very concerned about the space end of that because the idea that space should be reserved for peaceful purposes is part of international law. But during the 90s, great progress was made in developing the doctrine for space control and even the hardware to exercise space control.
Okay, now take us to the present. Take us to the present in the sense of what are the capabilities of the United States, Russia, and China vis-a-vis space weapons? What's the state of the art today?
Well, the state of the art is this. The United States is many, 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 many years ahead of China and the United and Russia in terms of being able to control space with anti-satellite weapons. We are working on several techniques. The most important, really, is small robotic satellites that can be launched into space and seek and find and rendezvous with any satellite we want them to. And, of course, if you can rendezvous with another satellite, then you can do damaging things to it. We call these robotic satellites peaceful in that they could service future American satellites. But you can call that peaceful if you want. But if you can, come up to another satellite and service it, you can also destroy it or damage it. We're very far along in these programs. We're also working on a ground-based laser system that could damage or possibly even destroy satellites of other nations in space.
And in fact, wasn't there a Star Wars test, maybe 10 years ago, where the space shuttle was supposed to intercept a laser beam from the planet Earth? However, they misread inches and meters. And as a consequence of that, the media picked up on it. Because we misread meters and inches, the space shuttle oriented itself toward outer space rather than toward the Earth. And as a consequence, the Star Wars test failed. But isn't it true, therefore, that we are using the space shuttle to test space weapons in the sense that we shoot lasers, very low-power lasers, at the space shuttle?
Well, I wouldn't call those weapons tests. We are researching lasers, and in fact, we illuminated a satellite in 1997 with a low-power laser. But we are working on the technology. But the main thing we're working on are these robotic small satellites, because they have the potential for doing almost anything we want to in space. They have the potential for hitting targets in low Earth orbit, which are just a few hundred miles above the Earth, or in higher orbits, many thousands of miles above the Earth. That's where the big threat is right now, and other countries understand this. They're very very keen on developing a treaty that would stop the development of such weapons.
Now, isn't it true that smaller nations like India, being outgunned and being overwhelmed by U.S. technology, have issued some dark threats that they may launch what is called a keg of nails? A keg of nails would be a barrel of nails with gunpowder inside, very low tech. You simply detonate it in outer space, and since most satellites are European and U.S. satellites, these nails then basically wipe out a good chunk of U.S. systems.
Well,
so
that's one of the ultimate nightmares in the space business. It's very easy to destroy a satellite, any kind of satellite of any size, by putting debris, pellets, gravel, nails, whatever, in the orbital path. And then that idea has been around for at least 40 years, and it's a terrible thing if you do that. And if you do several of those, you could drain the space almost forever.
Now, the question is, who would suffer the most if there is a showdown in outer space? The Chinese have an expression, never pick up a rock only to drop it on your own feet. Now that the United States is reaching for superiority in outer space, the question is, will it drop it on its own feet? So who would suffer the most if war breaks out in space?
Well, you're getting to the heart of an important issue, a dispute between a lot of high-level military people, mainly in the Air Force, and civilian hardliners. The high-level military people in the Air Force tend to argue we have the most to lose, meaning the United States, about 850 active satellites are in orbit, and about half of those, a little bit more than half, are American. So if we ever had a conflict in space, we would stand the risk of losing many, many, many of our own satellites. So the argument, and I've heard this from colonels and generals, the argument is, why are we being so belligerent in our space policy? Why are we using rhetoric and developing hardware that might start another arms race? Because if the arms race ever turns into a conflict, we do have a lot to lose.
Now, if you have two gunfighters about to shoot it out at OK Corral, and one gunfighter grabs sand and throws sand in the enemy's eyes, blinding the enemy, that's like space war, in which case the blinded gunfighter then shoots randomly in all directions. So if it does come to space war, not only do we have all the space debris in outer space, but won't the blinded enemies basically fire randomly and create even more havoc?
Well, that's another important argument. War games have borne this out, that if we play a war game, and if we, as you put it, blind the other side by damaging their satellite, there's going to be retaliation. It's going to be much more random than it would have been otherwise. It's a very dangerous business to take out the other nation's satellite. I have to emphasize that a lot of military people are really against this aggressive space policy we're talking about. There's a real split here between hardliners, neoconservatives, triumphalists on the one side, and fairly sober military people on the other side.
Now, Vladimir Putin has basically gone ballistic over the Star Wars anti-missile system being based in Eastern Europe, even though the United States has tried to reassure it that it's basically to be used against Iran and, quote, rogue nations. The Russians are fuming that it's basically in their sphere of influence. So tell us what's happening now in Europe.
Well, you know, we are talking about having two facilities in Europe, and the Russians are very unhappy about that, because it would be a little bit like the Russians putting a couple of systems into Canada. I mean, it's right on their doorstep, as Canada is on ours. And if you put facilities on their doorstep, who's to say that 10 years from now that we won't use them in other ways as coercive tools against Moscow? It's a very ambiguous situation. Countries or national leaders look at the intentions of other countries, but they mainly look at capabilities. Intentions can change, but capabilities do not change so easily. And if one country has a lot of power in one area, they may say, we will not use it now, but 10 years from now, the intentions may change, and the Russians are very conscious of that.
And Putin even raised the stakes last year when he put his weapons basically on alert status and threatened Europe with nuclear retaliation. So this is really upping the stakes, right? And while in the United States there's almost no publicity around this, the Russians are fuming.
Well, they're fuming, but this alert business is rhetorical. Both countries, both the United States and Russia, have weapons on alert, and they say they're detargeted, but it's just a matter of, it would take a matter of minutes to retarget them. It's done for rhetorical effect. It's not a strategic change, in my opinion.
Now let's talk about China. If you read the Chinese concerns, first of all, they believe that a Star Wars system would decouple Taiwan away from mainland China. And China has said, more or less, that there's only one scenario in which they would unleash the power of their military, and that is over Taiwan. So isn't the United States touching very sensitive areas when there is a possible decoupling of Taiwan from China, in which case China has already stated that it will go to war?
Well, the Chinese-Taiwan situation, I think, has been handled very clumsily in this country. You're quite right. The Chinese will not tolerate a true independence move by Taiwan. On the other hand, the Taiwanese tend to act very independently in many areas, and we have sold them weapons for years and years and years. It's always a tense situation. And the space assets used for military purposes have accentuated this. One of the favorite war games being played in the military over here is, what if the Chinese launch a surprise attack against satellites, which are, in effect, surveilling China and Taiwan? What if they blind us? What do we do then? And this is kind of a silly scenario. The Chinese have no interest in taking on the United States militarily. They make goods for the United States. They make goods for the Western world, and they need those jobs. Meanwhile, we need the Chinese. The Chinese are buying roughly $200 billion worth of treasury notes and bonds every year. That keeps our interest rates low. We're in bed together financially, economically, so why would there be a military challenge from China? Why can't we cooperate? We're in a new century. I think the old Cold War paradigms don't work anymore.
Now, it's been noted that even a limited Star Wars shield might might conceivably be affected not against 1,000 missiles, but against 20 missiles. And it's also been pointed out that the Chinese have approximately 20 missiles that might be able to reach California. Now, given the mathematics of the fact that even a limited Star Wars system might be affected against a full-scale Chinese attack on California, isn't that concern on the part of the Chinese?
It's been a concern since the 70s. Our limited, so-called limited missile defense system proposed in the 70s was advertised by McNamara as an anti-Chinese system. And war games today still look at the Chinese threat, I put threat in quotation marks, and the anti-ballistic missile system, which we advertise as being aimed at North Korea and Iran, is viewed by very many military people and hardliners as an anti-Chinese system, as a way of hedging our bets against the so-called Chinese threat. The Chinese understand this perfectly well. Everybody in the military space business understands that it well, too. Our anti-ballistic missile system is not aimed at North Korea or Iran. It's aimed at China.
And let's say a few things about Iran. It was just announced yesterday that Israel, senior officials in Israel, have just announced that it appears as if an attack on Iran is inevitable. So some people say, in defense of a Star Wars-type shield and Star Wars-type funding, they say that warfare in the future will be waged from outer space, like the Persian Gulf War. Most of that was actually waged from the air rather than from the ground. So what do you say to those people who say that in order to defend Israel or in other regional conflicts, we have to dominate space?
Well, I say to those people that it's fantastical that aggressive moves in space are more likely to start a war than to prevent a war.
Well, I'm afraid that's it for Exploration. Once again, go to my website and you can find out what cities I'll be traveling in on the West Coast concerning my new paperback book, The Future of Humanity, a New York Times bestseller. Go to mkaku.org, mkaku.org, and it gives you the places where I'll be speaking on the West Coast for the paperback book tour. And again, if you want a copy of today's program, call the Pacifica Program Service at 1-800-735-0230. So for a copy of today's program, call the Pacifica Program Service at 1-800-735-0230 and go to my website, mkaku.org, mkaku.org.